Hi there. In this quick tutorial, I'm going to talk about all the different options for rendering a scene, and I'll also cover how to render an animation in Blender Cycles. So here's a render of a very simple test scene. I've got some diffuse and glosses, some refractive and transparent surfaces, simple reflective surface, and this more complicated surface, which also has a subsurface scattering effect on it. So one of the first things to be aware of is the size that you're going to render at. So 1920 by 1080 is a common frame size. I'm going to get into the animation settings in a little bit, which is what this covers. But typically this wide format is quite a good one to render to, though there are various different aspect ratios. And you can either set them directly with pixels here, or you can just change the aspect ratio here. So obviously increasing this one makes it narrower, increasing this one makes it more letterbox, but the aspect ratio itself is set by these pixels. You can very quickly increase or decrease the overall size of your image with this. Nothing obvious will happen to the camera view, but when you render it, it will obviously render a lot quicker. If I set this to 10% and render that, you can see it renders very quickly, but it's a very small low resolution image. If you were to set this to 200, it will obviously render a much larger scene. If I zoom out, you can see it's rendering different tiles as we go. That's all I'll cover in that section at the moment. Metadata, basically this is information that's included in the file. It's not visible when you look at it as an image or a movie, but is stored within the file. So you might want to put information such as who the creator was. It might be relevant to where that image or movie clip belongs in a larger project, and so on and so forth. So that's information you can put there. This is where we output files. Most of this is more relevant to an animation, with the exception of this section here. So here you can specify the color depth. I'd suggest for most purposes, 8 bits color depth is fine, but certainly if you want a higher quality image and you want more subtle shading, you might need to go for 16 bits. And then we can have a black and white image, a color, which is what RGB means, red, green, blue, or red, green, blue, and alpha, which basically means that you can render the scene with transparent areas. So if you're going to do that, you might do that particularly with an animation where you're going to include this over perhaps some live action video. If you want to do that, one of the settings you'll need to click is this one. But you'll also need to come down to where it says film and click transparent. And that will allow you to have a transparent background. If I move my background to another layer, and now render this one, but I'm going to just set the dimensions back down to 50%. So you can now see it's rendering my scene. My background's not visible at the moment, which is why these have gone dark, but the background has got this sort of checker pattern, which basically means it's a transparent part of the image. And as long as you save it in a file format that will use that, then that will work. And in terms of outputting a single image, we can just come down here and say save as image or save a copy. We say save as image, we get to choose where we're going to save the image. My default is PNG, and obviously we can select that here as well. If you save it as JPEG, you won't be able to save transparency. You can set it to a particular color, and then you can use that to key your transparency later. And I'll just call that layer back up so that when we render, we get a background again. So one other little thing about choosing the color depth, when you have very subtle shadings in the background, particularly with things like sky, which are very bright, but also have some quite subtle changes, you'll sometimes get an effect which is called alias noise, which is basically you get sort of bands appearing. It seems like a band, and then they'll have a little bit of noise between them, and then it'll be a slightly different color band and so on as it shifts from one point to another. And they can be quite noticeable, especially in animations. Setting this to 16 won't completely remove those bands, but it will give the computer the ability to store images with more subtle shades from one to another. And then it's down to whether your monitor and your eye can detect the difference. So that will help a little. What you'll often find is the bands are still there, but more narrow. But if you come down to post-processing, the real way to get rid of them, if you're having them, is to use dither, which is where colors are very, very close together. It sort of mixes them up, scrambles the pixels at the border between those two chunks of shading. So you just set dither up a little bit, and that's all I use if I'm finding I'm getting a bit of alias noise on the sky or whatever other effect. It doesn't significantly affect the quality of your image, but it does make it a little smoother. If anything, it makes the quality better. But for most purposes, you don't need transparent, and therefore I'll turn it off in both places. If you turn this on, it will still render with a transparent background, but you need RGBA to be able to save it as a format that can contain transparent information. Compression is down obviously to the file format. Different file formats have different compression. There are some that don't have any. PNG, I don't believe that's a lossy compression. So the only reason for not using compression is if it's lossy, really, or if you're having to save a lot of files. So I very often render my animations as a strip of image files, and I'll talk about that in a little bit. But obviously they can get quite large, especially if I don't have any compression. Now, if that's lossy compression, basically what it does is it looks at the image and says, well, you're probably not going to see the difference between this pixel and this pixel, so I'm going to make them the same and just say there are 2 pixels and here they are, and they're the same color, rather than storing their individual values. That's called lossy compression, and that's along the lines of what a JPG or JPEG compression does. It looks at the differences between things, and if they're less than a certain amount, it throws away that difference and just says they're the same. And that's why you get a sort of blockiness, but it's more associated with the color than it is the detail. Lossless compression is a bit more like zip on a Windows PC. It's just looking for common pieces of information and saying, well, all of these pixels can go in that bucket over there. They're all that color, rather than restoring the values for each of those individual pixels. It's just saying they're that color and this is where they are. So it's only got to store where they are and categorize them, as it were. It's not throwing any information away. The downside of that is obviously it requires a lot of processing power, so it can be slower to save an image. Now, if it's a single image, you're probably not that worried. I imagine the time to render it is going to be much longer than the time to save it. But if you're saving, say, 1,000 images because it's an animation, then every second that you add to that, that's another 1,000 seconds to create your animation. So you tend to be looking to all sorts of different ways to shave off time. So you may want to think again about whether you use compression, unless, of course, you've got problems with storage space, in which case you would want to use it. You may also find that 16 is perhaps slightly slower to render, but that may not be the case. Freestyle is a very special type of rendering, and it's really it's a stylized form of rendering. It's a completely different area in itself. Looks very simple until you turn it on and start playing with it, and there are settings elsewhere in Blender as well. I'm not going to go into that in detail in this one. Then we come down to sampling. So this is really the quality of the image. So we've got render and preview, and you've got quick presets there, and you can create your own presets here, of course. So the default is path tracing. If I set render to 10 samples, so this is actual render, not preview, and I press F12 to render, that's taking 2.31 seconds to render. It's quite a low quality image, obviously. If I press square samples, this has got nothing to do with the shape of the samples. It's a mathematical thing. And you can now see we're at 100 samples. So it's basically squaring the number I put in there as a very quick way to switch from whatever value I've got in there to a much higher value. So it might be you do lots of preview renders, because a render, actually F12, an actual render, is always going to have more in it than the preview render. So it's the same as pressing this button here, the camera symbol. So you can see that's a much higher quality image. So I'll turn off square samples there. And the other way of looking at an image, obviously, is clicking here and saying rendered, and this gives you a preview render. I'm going to press 0, and that makes us look through the camera. When you render, you'll always render what's in the view of the active camera, which is the only camera you've got if you've stuck with the default one. But you'll get more effects like properly calculated ambient occlusion and things like that when you actually render than when you use preview render. So preview render is exactly that. It's designed to be quick and just give you a general view. It's good enough for developing textures and working out where your reflections are and things like that, but you need to do an actual render, even if it's a low resolution one, in order to really see how your scene is working. You can press F11 at any time, by the way, to go back to your rendered scene, as long as you haven't closed the program. So we've got two options under here, path tracing and branched path tracing. I very rarely use branched path tracing, but you can use it if you want to be more selective in what you render in your scene. So I've selected branched path tracing, and I've accepted the defaults. So this is anti-aliased samples, so this basically covers removing noise artifacts from the fact that this is a digital display where the pixel is either here or here, it's not anywhere in between. And it's saying sample all direct lights and all indirect lights. And then there's a pattern to use. This is obviously just the mathematical options in how they calculate light samples. So clamp, light sampling, everything is 0 at the moment. Not going to worry about seed. That applies really to animation, as does that little clock. And all of the samples are set to 1. So let's press F12 and see what sort of sample we get. And you see that render very quickly. So that's great. It only took 2 seconds. But you can see it's a very noisy scene. So one of the things that's particularly noisy is this object here, which has got subsurface scattering on it. And you can see that's an option down here in terms of material. So this is the number of subsurface scattering samples to render. So let's put this up to 5 and render again. I'm in slot 3 at the moment. I've got some other things in slot 1 and 2. This basically is a quick way for you to compare your renders to perhaps look at not only how long they took to render, but how they compare in terms of quality. So I'm going to go to slot 4 and press F12 to render again. You can see this is taking much longer now, and that took 6.3 seconds. You're probably thinking, well, all of this is the same. The only part that really changed is this one, because this is the only one with subsurface scattering on. So if I now compare that to slot 3, you can see how noisy this one is compared to slot 4. So if I put that back down to 1 and I go to diffuse and we'll set that to 5, I'll press F12 and let's compare. So it's mostly the surface down here now, because obviously these surfaces are dominated by glossy more than they are diffuse. So there's slot 3 and there's slot 4, and you can see slot 4, there's quite a bit less noise, especially where we've got these caustics showing here. And therefore you can selectively say, well, the most important thing to me is this surface, and therefore I'm going to put more samples into that surface. Whereas when you use path tracing, you're applying those samples to the whole lot. So I can't selectively choose a particular surface to increase samples on. But be aware that there is these AA samples being applied. If you like, they're being multiplied. You can easily get to a point where the number of samples will be greater than you can handle in the memory of your card, and you'll get a CUDA error if you're using a GPU. It probably won't be greater than you can handle if you're using CPU, but it could take a very long time to render. You saw that went from 2 seconds to 6 seconds, so that was 3 times as long to render for just going from 1 to 5. So that's a useful way if you want to be able to render a higher quality for a specific surface, or control the quality of the render for specific surfaces. But for most things, you're going to use path tracing. So as I've said, this is applicable more to animation, and it's really the pattern that it uses to select what pixel it's going to work on next, and affects the pattern of noise. Clamp direct and clamp indirect. So if we go back to slot 3, and we will render this at 25 frames. And let that go, so F12, and then we go to slot 4, and we'll now put clamp direct and indirect at 7 and render it again. So if we have a look first of all at the render times, slot 3 was 5.23 seconds, slot 4 was 5.5, so slightly slower, not a problem for a single scene, but potentially a problem for an animation if it starts to get more than that. But how about the look of the frames? So there's actually, it's subtle, you might not really be able to see it on the video, but you can see a little bit of extra noise around here. So there's slot 4, the shadows are more well defined, and slot 3, you can see they light up a little bit. So there's more noise in there. And obviously when you do it at higher samples, that's more visible. And you can particularly see it here in that reflection. So if I go to slot 3, it's because we're looking up at these surfaces from this reflection where there's more shadow. So you can see slot 3, the surface is almost, you really can't see the detail of the shadows here. And slot 4, they become much more visible. Essentially, there's bright spots in there. They're not quite fireflies, but they're heading in that direction. And clamping helps to remove those fireflies by saying, if I've got a bright pixel that's surrounded by darker pixels, only allow it to be brighter by a certain amount. Now, the larger this number, obviously it allows it to be brighter by a larger amount, so the noise is greater, until you turn this down to 0, and then it doesn't do any clamping at all. So other than when it's at 0, if I put this to 1, for example, that's now going to be a fairly severe clamp. So let's go to slot 5 for this one, and then compare that with slot 4. You can probably see, if I zoom in a little bit, this is a low resolution render at the moment, so it is relatively noisy anyway. Notice all these little bright spots, and now I go to slot 5, and they've all disappeared. However, we have a look at our sphere here. If we go to slot 4, notice we've got a hint of something here, a reflection more than it is noise, and then go to slot 5, notice how much darker that reflection is there. That's because it's being clamped quite severely. So essentially we lose what's called the dynamics of our scene. If I go to 3, you can see how much brighter these caustics are. It'll particularly affect caustics, and then go to 5, and they're much dimmer. So you won't get the more significant variations in your scene if you clamp too much. You obviously have to set that to the value that's right for your scene. So I'm going to set those back to 7. 7 seems to be a good number. Somewhere between 7 and 14 seems to be a good number. The bigger it is, of course, as I say, the more subtle it is. Light sampling. I haven't found this to make a huge difference, but in theory, if you set this to 0, you will get a less noisy image, but it'll take slightly longer to render. So if we go back to slot 4. I'll re-render it. By the way, clamp direct is light that are coming straight to the camera. Indirect is light that's bouncing off something before it gets to the camera or passing through something. So that took 5.5 seconds to render and has that amount of noise. We'll go back to slot 5 and we'll set light sampling up a bit. We'll set it to 1, the extreme. It's always worth doing that just to see what it does. So that one took 5.3 seconds, the other one took 5.5 seconds. So light sampling threshold at 0 gave us a render time of 5.5. Light sampling threshold at 1 gave a sample time of 5.3, so 0.2 of a second for this particular scene. But that might equate to several seconds for a higher quality image, and several seconds multiplied by a strip of, say, 1,000 frames, well, that's 1,000 or 2,000 seconds that are going to be added to your time to render. So that might be significant. However, as I'm sure you can see already, if we look particularly on this background between slot 5 and slot 4, that's almost an acceptable amount of noise on that background, almost. But on that one, it's really quite bad unless it's a really stylized look that you're going for. So that's the payoff, really. You get a slightly shorter render, but you will have a lot more noise. And it's to do with where Blender stops doing its calculations when it's working out how much light is being represented as coming from a particular pixel. So generally, I have that at 0 because the difference is relatively subtle, because I'd rather have a cleaner image, which then might mean I can render at lower samples than a slightly faster one. But it's there as an option. Render and preview, obviously, render is literally the number of samples we render at, and preview is the number of samples that we preview at. So typically you don't have them the same. You might have preview at 10. And preview is when we use this down here to say viewport shading rendered. A little comment about this box that I'm getting. So you see it's not rendering anything out here at the moment, which is helping the preview render to be a lot quicker. If I shift out of camera view and just pull the viewport round a little, you can see it takes longer because it's now rendering everything. That's achieved by this little tick box up here. If I untick that, you can now see it's rendering everything. It's still slightly darker around there, for my setup anyway, but it is rendering all of it. Generally speaking, if you're looking through camera view, you don't need to do that. So click that, and that will actually make your preview renders go a little faster. Another little point about preview renders. We often want to sort of move a scene around and look at a scene, or maybe watch a simple animation in preview render mode. So I'm going to put preview to 5 samples now. But you can see it sort of does big blocks and then they get smaller and smaller. If something's changing, such as like this, when I'm moving the scene around, it's quite difficult sometimes to see exactly what's going on. So if we go to performance, you can see there's a start resolution there for the viewport. If we put that to a higher number, so I'll try 128, you can now see, we can actually see a bit more detail. It's slower, however, so I'll now put it up to 256. It's not increasing the quality of the final viewport render, it's increasing the size of the blocks that it, or decreasing the size of the blocks that it's starting with. In other words, improving the resolution. So you can now see, as I'm moving it around, we could actually see the edge of that sphere. And you can go even higher than that. Let's try 512. Now it's having a little bit of trouble keeping up, but at least we can see a lot more of the detail of my scene. But if you want speed, then obviously go back to the default, and now I can move it around much more quickly. I just lose the fine detail when I do so. So geometry. I've covered volume sampling in my volumetric tutorials before, but essentially step size you can equate to the resolution of a volumetric surface in here, or it's not even a surface, something like mist or smoke. So the smaller this number, the higher the quality. You'll want a higher quality, or at least the default quality, if you've got a lot of wisps of smoke, or you've got lots of perhaps light beams shining through it and things like that. The higher that quality, the more sharply they will be defined. Conversely, the maximum steps, the larger that number, the more memory is allocated to carry out the calculations to understand how a volume is working. The defaults are pretty good. I very often turn that up to 0.15. Obviously, if you've got volumetrics in the scene, this number will affect how long it takes to render. So very often, especially if it's very subtle volumetrics, I'll actually turn this number up, maybe even as high as 0.2, so double, in order to reduce the render times, especially if it's an animation. Use hair literally just turns off hair particles. Curl back faces, basically for hair particles, don't worry about whether there's a surface that you can't see. Just worry about the surface you can see. And min pixels, so if a hair particle is so small that it would be less than a number you set here, so 1 pixel, for example. If it would be less than 1 pixel, then don't bother with rendering it. Less than 1 might be a bit too big, but if a hair particle is less than 0.5 of a pixel, you could argue it's going to have very little effect on the scene, and therefore you may as well not render it. So then we come down to light paths. I've covered a lot of this before. Obviously with things like lamps, you already have an option for bounces and things like that, but you can also control them in here. There are some presets and you can create your own, but these will affect how long it takes to carry out your render and the quality of your render. So there's 3 main tick boxes to worry about. If we go to preview mode, the shadow tick box is more about understanding whether a transparent or semi-transparent surface is casting a shadow. You might get this particularly with alpha objects where you've got a leaf using an image with a transparency in it, and you want the outline of the image casting a shadow rather than the actual perhaps little square object that you're using for a leaf. So generally you leave that on. Caustics is one generally that I don't have ticked. Now I have caustics in this scene, which is these little bright patches of light caused by the refraction of light through this sphere. So if I go to slot 5, and then I turn off refractive and reflective caustics and give that a render, and it will show in the preview render as well, though not as well. Now you can see I've got a shadow underneath my sphere, but no light. You can see the big difference. However, the other thing is there's a lot less noise in the scene. So between 5 and 4, look at the noise over here on this object. So that's with caustics on. And then with caustics off, you can see it's much less noise. So in this scene, caustics are quite significant, so that's why they're switched on. But for most scenes that don't have objects like this, whether it's water drops, water lying on a surface, water in the air, or large objects that are going to refract or reflect light in non-planar ways. So this doesn't cause caustics, but perhaps the curve on its edge would. Obviously this causes caustics, both the reflected light that reflects it onto this object here, as well as the, and mostly the light that passes through it, and it forms a kind of lens. So it's only if that's significant do you need reflective and refractive caustics on. And of course you can have one on and not the other. So generally turn those off, and that will make for a faster render and a less noisy render. And then we can look at the bounces. So bounces are how many times light can bounce around before Blender assumes it's never going to reach the camera. One thing worth remembering, when it does a render, it doesn't really work from the lamp, bounce its light through everything and then say which beams of light hit the camera, because that would be a very inefficient way of working. It would have to be working out every light beam that it decides to emit from the lamp and where it went. Did it go off into infinity? Did it miss the camera entirely? So what they do is they actually almost project beams from the camera itself, and if they hit a light source, then they work back from that and say, oh right, so I've got a bit of light bouncing off. So if you imagine there's a light up here, there's obviously a strip light up here, what's happened there is a beam has come from the camera, bounced off this sphere, bounced up here, and then, oh look, it hit a lamp. So Blender said, ah right, so I've got a light beam here that's successfully bouncing off this sphere and hitting the camera. But there'll be beams from the light that go off this way, or perhaps bounce off there and bounce off into infinity, that Blender doesn't know anything about. It didn't bother calculating them. Bear that in mind. Although we think in terms of the way light works in the real world, of coming out of a lamp, bouncing off something into the camera, Blender works the other way. And the reason that that's important is because bounces is what it's all, other than direct lights, bounces is what it's all about. If there were no bounces, we'd only see the light sources if there were no bounces. And you can set it to 0, renders very quickly, but doesn't look very good. Bounces also gives you the subtlety of shadows, because obviously it's how much light is bouncing. As the distance between this sphere and the ground gets greater, the number of opportunities for light to come in and bounce off the floor are greater. And that's why the shadow is less dark. But right here, right underneath the sphere, there's a lot less opportunities for light to come in and bounce off there, and therefore it's darker. So you can reduce the number of bounces, and that will certainly speed up your render, but obviously below a certain point you will lose some of the definition of the image. That said, you can still render reasonably well with very few bounces. So for example, if I go to a new scene, I'll add a simple plane, bring that up a little bit, and then we'll add a UV sphere about there, and then we'll add a point lamp. So this is a light that shines in all directions, and we'll see what that looks like just with the default settings. So there it is, still fairly noisy, but we're only rendering 10 samples. But that's got max bounces set to 1024. What if we take this right down and we go further? So that's 380, 16, still not much difference at the moment, and then down to 0. So at 0, you can start to see a difference. There's nothing over here. If I put it up to 1, you can see we immediately get a little bit more of the sphere there. And then 2, 3, 4. All that's really happening is that the shading's getting a little more subtle around here, where light's actually bouncing backward and forward. If I put the size up to 1, so that's a much more diffuse light now, and then take the bounces down to 0, that's actually a reasonably acceptable image, even though there's no bounces at all for the light. If I take the size down to 0, now that's looking a little strange. As soon as I put it up to 1, we start to get some more shading. And in fact, if I set the sphere to smooth shading, and we'll press Control 2 to put a subdivision surface to give some more surfaces on there, you can see with, it's going to move my light source so I can see it even in rendered view. So you can see even with one bounce, we're starting to get some more subtle shading. So 0, it's trying to give us some subtlety, but you can see it's not doing very well. But 1, we immediately see a lot more detail. And 2, you can see between 1 and 2, so 1 gives us some extra light on the object, but we've got a very sharp differentiation between the shadow and the unshaded area. And then we go to 2 bounces, and immediately we start to get some shading in here. And as we go to more, it just gets a little more subtle, and we can go up quite high, and there's not a great deal of difference. So what that tells you is, for a single light source, you don't necessarily need an awful lot of bounces. So this will override the bounces that we've got in here for that particular light source, and obviously this reduces your render times as well. So do think about that when you're using your light sources. Obviously, when you've got a lot more objects in the scene, you don't necessarily want very, very low bounces, but it may be that you're only trying to illuminate a particular object in your scene with a particular lamp, and therefore it might not need huge numbers of bounces. So coming down, we come to another section called motion blur. Now this is really to do with animation. And essentially, this allows you to add the effect of motion blur. So in a real camera, in order to expose each frame, the shutter, the aperture of the camera, is opened for a particular amount of time, say a 25th or a 50th of a second, exposes light on the film, and then closes again, effectively, as the film's moved on to the next frame. For things that are moving very quickly, even though it's a relatively short amount of time, an object can have moved or can be moving while that frame is being exposed. So it's very much like trying to take a single photo of perhaps a bird flying past you. Unless it's a very bright scene and your shutter speed is very fast, you may find that the bird is somewhat blurred because it's moving while the shutter is open. Whether it's with a film camera or a modern CCD camera, it takes time for the light to gather on the light sensing part of the camera. So that's what causes motion blur, the fact that an object is moving fast enough to be in more than one spot, significantly more than one spot, while the camera's aperture is open and receiving light. So when we create 3D graphics, obviously, because it's completely artificial, by default, there is no motion blur, no matter how fast the object is moving. It may be that between one frame and another, one moment the sphere might be here, and then in the next frame it could be here. So it's moving very, very quickly. But because this is CG, we still have a perfect frame no matter how fast this sphere is moving. So in order to simulate the effect of motion blur, which we all sort of unconsciously expect to see in a fast moving object, because we are conscious of how, or unconscious of how, movies work, we tick motion blur. So you can see we've got the shutter indicated here. So the shutter is what is opening and closing to accept light. So this is just an arbitrary blender unit, but at 0.5 we will get a certain amount of interpolation. So what it will do is it will say anything that is moving beyond a certain speed will have a blur applied to it in the direction of travel across the XY coordinates of the rendered scene. So if this sphere was moving very quickly between here and here, there would be a blurred version of the sphere represented at all the points between where it was in the previous frame and where it is in the current frame. It effectively renders extra frames to work that out. So you'll see it going backward. It'll be rendering frame before, frame after, as it were, and it'll say, well, I'm going to have this much blur because it's moving this fast. It works out the speed, if you like, of all the pixels that make up that object, and smears them across the movement of that object. And you can apply various different curves to that here. So motion blur just simulates the movement of an object that is moving fast enough to have caused blur in a real camera. And you might want to use that even for a still frame, because obviously you may be representing perhaps a racing car moving fast an otherwise stationary scene. So then we come down to film. I've already mentioned about the transparent option. Exposure is obviously going to set how bright your scene is, and then there are various calculation methods here. We should at this point mention a little bit about color management. Depending on how your default is set up, we now have, as part of Blender 2.7.9 and onward, the filmic option. So filmic, you will hear that it's the preferred option. It's what you should use. The reason for filmic is, without going into a lot of detail, there is a finite amount of information that can be represented on a computer screen. Your eyes are much more sensitive to different levels of light than a computer screen can show you. The computer is capable of being aware of many, many levels, but nevertheless, your eyes are more subtle in that respect, and they can compensate for the general brightness of a scene. As a result, in real life, if you've got a bright window and an otherwise relatively dark room, for example, your eyes will adjust depending on what part of the scene you're looking at. So if you're looking at the bright window, your pupils will get smaller, allowing you to see out of the window and see the scene beyond. But the result of that, although you may not be conscious of it, is that the room will become darker because you're actually stopping down the amount of light that can enter your eye. When you look at other parts of the scene in view, your pupils will open up a little bit because they will recognize, your brain will realize that there isn't as much light coming in, and they will therefore receive more light. That said, at that point, your peripheral vision, which can still see the window, will see the window as a washed out bright object. There won't be very much detail visible in it. However, when we look at an image in a rendered picture, whether it's a movie or a still, obviously we can see all of it and we can look at any part of the scene. And really, the computer's only got so many light levels that it can display, so your eye isn't really able to adjust to see these different things. And there's only a limited range that the computer screen can display anyway. So sRGB is the standard system that most computer screens will display with, but Filmic basically applies a mathematical curve to that to allow data that would normally be lost but be sort of crushed either up into the whites or the dark area to be visible. So I brought up some menus on the left hand side, and you can see what this particular scene looks like. So this histogram is showing you that. Now, if I turn the exposure up, you can see everything's moving up toward the right. And if we look at the actual scene, all the brights have got brighter and even the dark areas have got brighter. But we've obviously lost quite a lot of information, particularly in the brighter areas, particularly here. So if I now turn the exposure down, you can see everything's moving to the left and carry on going down. So we've got more information. We can see more parts of this model here, but in these darker areas, they've all disappeared. So what we need is something that's going to stretch these darker areas and stretch these lighter areas. There's still only this amount of space to represent data. I'm already using Filmic here. If I was to switch to RAW, for example, you can see we've got quite a bit of data visible there, that's quite well exposed, but we've lost a lot of information here. We can't really see what's going on there. And we can play around with the exposure, and you can see when we get to a point where we can start to see the information here, accepting this is a low resolution, low samples image, we've lost all the data here. We've got just got white, you notice we've got nothing up here. We have various different curves that we can apply here. So log is an attempt to sort that out, and now you can see it's very washed out, but nevertheless we've got data that we can see here, we can see information here, so we can pretty much see all of the scene. So something like log is often used as a sort of basis that you then, when you're going to composite the image into your animation or whatever it is, when you're going to do the final processing, you might then start to play with things like the gamma and what have you to match all your elements together and to give you the ultimate scene you want. But Filmic is an attempt to approach what you get from real film, which is sensitive enough to give you a lot more information. So you can see the defaults for Filmic start to give us more information here, and then we've got various options here. So we can select everything from base contrast, which is the default, low, we go for very low contrast, very much like that logarithmic scale. We've got a lot of information in the scene. You can see the maximum amount of information is close to the middle of the scene, and there's only a little bit down here that's lost in the darkness. And then if we go to very high contrast, you can see it stretched it all out. So we've lost a little bit down here. You can see that's this area here, but we've got a lot of differentiation between elements of the scene. And you can go for something like medium contrast, and that sort of is the best of both worlds. Or typically just use base contrast and then just play around with gamma and things like that. So you can see gamma is another curve. That's what this is. It's a gamma curve. If we say use curves, you can even define your own curves. So a classical one is to use an S curve. And you can see you can play around with this. So this is brightening up areas and darkening other areas, until you get the look that you want. I'm just going to turn that off. So that's color management. And there's a lot more that could be said about that. I could go into a lot more detail. But essentially, the general advice is to use Filmic. So then we get to tiles down here. So I have this option enabled, auto tile. We go up to File, User Preferences, type tile in here, and you can see there's an add-on called Render Auto Tile Size. If you enable that, this option will appear here. So tiles are these objects. You see that's divided it into four tiles. The idea of auto tile size, if you click it, is it will select a target tile size which it thinks will be optimal in terms of speed of render for the processor you're using to render the scene. So if it's a CPU, it will generally select quite a small tile. Reason being, most of us have multiple CPUs or cores in our CPU, in our central processing unit. So if I change to CPU mode and press F12, you can see it selected some very small tiles. I've got four cores. It's a relatively old PC now. But what that means is I've got four processors working on rendering a tile independently. You can actually control that. That's currently, so that's threads if you like. And it's defaulted to saying I'm going to use all the processors. But let's say you wanted to be doing something else while you're using the computer. You can say fixed. You could say I only want you to use three threads because you know you've got four processors. Now if I press F12, you can see it's only doing three tiles at once. That means you've got one core left to go and do something else. It won't impact significantly the render time going on here because you're using a processor which is otherwise idle. That's true for using CPU render. If we go back to preferences again, this time go to system. If you have a card that supports either CUDA or there is another system that I forget at the moment, you'll have an option here. So if it says none, then you haven't got a graphics card that Blender can use to render with. If it says CUDA or OpenCL, I think it is the other option, you can click that and then however many graphics GPUs you've got will appear down here. And you can select the one you want to use. You can see I'm using a GTX 980. Once you've done that, if you click here, you can then select between your CPU or your GPU. So let's just compare this. I'm going to go back to auto detect for my threads, and let's render this scene with the settings we've got. So that took 29.77 seconds. We now go to GPU without changing any other settings. Because we've only got one processor to use in the GPU, it selected a single tile, but quite a large tile. And this time it only took 5.5 seconds. And that's because a GPU is specially optimized to do tasks like rendering. So typically, if you can, use your GPU. But if your GPU is crashing because it doesn't have enough memory for whatever scene you're trying to render, then obviously you can default to CPU. If there's a lot of work to do, it will take a lot longer though. You can see that's much, much faster in the GPU. You don't have to use tiles, however. You can select Progressive Refine. So this can be useful if, as I sometimes do, if you're rendering a single scene and you're not sure what level of quality you're going to need. So rather than setting a specific number and trying that and saying, no, that's not quite good enough, trying another number. So it might have taken an hour to render. You have a look at the result and you say, it's not really good enough. You can combine, by the way, if you do an hour's render and then you do another hour's render with a different seed under sampling, so you change the seed in here, you can combine those two images in something like Photoshop and the noise will be lessened as long as you use the right additive method. However, rather than messing around with that, what I used to do quite a lot is put something like 1,000 there. You may not at all intend to render at 1,000 samples. However, this is only going to work if you turn on Progressive Refine, because this will basically calculate the whole scene. It doesn't even use tiles. So if I say F12, you can see the whole scene is being updated. So I can just let it run. It's done. So far it's up to 30 something samples. And when I'm happy with the level of quality, I can just press escape and stop it. It will stop anyway when it gets to 1,000. But you can already see we're up to 100 samples now. It's not perfect. Obviously, if you're going to use denoising, this isn't an approach you can use, because the denoising is done after it's done the rendering. So I can stop there. And I now know if I let it render 250 samples, I'm going to get this level of quality, which might be satisfactory. This is where you can define the tile size yourself. So this add-on doesn't always get it right. So it says it calculates optimal. It's always worth trying other options. So if we render this one, so that took 5.47 seconds. Let's try a larger tile, which is 1024, and so big that it's actually bigger than the image. So it's effectively rendering it all. And that was actually rendered barely over 5 seconds. So that was actually quicker. However, you're more likely to run out of memory with such large tile sizes. If I did little tiny tiles and rendered that, the last one took 5 seconds. We're already up to 5 seconds and it's hardly rendered any of the scene at all. So you can see that's really not a good option if you're using the GPU. As I've already mentioned, Dither is probably the only one you're likely to use if you get alias distortion on particularly gradient backgrounds. Baking, that's a topic all on its own. Essentially allows you to bake things like the light sources or the shadows or even the colors into either an image or an image strip, which would allow you to effectively do something a bit like EV and have real-time movement in the scene, but with a pre-baked lighting and shading. I've done this in another video if you just search my channel for baking. And Texture Atlas is what you'll use when you bake in order to create images or files that contain all of that information. So that's the majority of the information for the still frame. So let's go back up and talk a little bit about creating an animation. So render you can just do with F12, or you can press this button. If you want to create an animation, you will need to click this button. But before you do that, as well as all the considerations that you would have had for a still scene, there's some extra stuff you need to look at. And that's really in this output section. So the first thing you need to do is tell it where you want the output to go and what you want it to be called. You can click in here and give it a name. And typically I put a dash after the name, and the reason for that is because I typically render to image sequences. So what it will do then is it will give it this 123F dash, and then it will put a number after it which represents the frame number. You can also then select the file type. So if you're not worried about transparency, if you're not worried about a bit of compression on the image, then perhaps JPEG will be suitable for you. If you are worried about the quality, you're going to want to use one of these higher quality options like TIFF or OpenEXR is a particular favorite. They're not as compatible with as many different video programs as something like PNG, but they are uncompressed and higher quality. If you're just creating a draft animation and it's not taking too long to render, you can use something like AVI JPEG or AVI RAW or even FFmpeg. All of these are movie outputs. But a word of warning, if Blender crashes or you need to stop it for some reason and it hasn't finished the animation, in many cases the right information is not going to be written to the file to allow you to play it or even use it afterward, even use it in Blender. So it may be that your output file will be unusable if it's a movie format if you stop Blender before it's finished. I don't know exactly why, but it's probably some sort of information that's appended to the end of the file when the successful render completes. Whereas if you render to an image file, you'll have all the frames that you've completed, and when you're ready, you can just start Blender up again and tell it to carry on from the frame that you wanted to render from, and there's no problem. Not only that, if, as sometimes happens, Blender has a little bit of a hiccup in one or two frames, maybe some strange artifact appears, but only in one or two frames, you can easily go back and re-render that particular frame, perhaps slightly adjusting the settings in order to overcome it. Whereas one of these movie options, it's a lot more difficult to do that. You'd have to sort of do a little mini render of a sequence and then try and stitch that in. A lot more work. Generally speaking, for the majority of things that I do, I almost always render an image sequence and I render it as PNG, which it is compressed, but it is lossless compression. And I use this 15% compression. If you need to be aware that if you use something like OpenEXR, the file sizes are going to be rather large. So bear that in mind when you're considering what you're going to do. I also normally, by the way, don't save them in amongst other files. I create a new folder specifically for my animation. And then, as you can see, you end up with a lot of different files like this, which are just image files. And you see each of these ones, which are compressed, are around 300 to 400K, half a meg almost. So they soon add up if there's a lot of them. Your animation sequence is going to be defined by the length of the animation you've got set up here. And obviously we say what frame you're going to start on and what frame you're going to end on. By default, it's 1 to 250. And then this defines the frame you're on. Up here under dimensions, we also have start frame and end frame. If you've already rendered, say from frame 1 to frame 100, when you reload Blender, you can say start at frame 101 and carry on till the end. You don't even have to render every frame. There might be a reason why you want to render every other frame, and that's it there. I'm not sure why you might want to do that, but you might. Frame rate really is how Blender interprets for the video output. Typically, I leave this as 25. For animation, that's fine. If you are combining the animation with perhaps some live action, then odds are that live action has probably been recorded at 29 frames a second or even higher. So you might therefore want to set that the same as the live action. In order to avoid any little glitches, you can sometimes get some strange glitches when you convert from your image strip or your movie file that's been created at, say, 25 frames a second, and then re-render that in either Blender or some other application to combine that into a video as, say, 29 frames. It's certainly something that caused me some problems. It's basically because 25 and 29, they don't map perfectly. So once a second or a couple of times a second, there'd be a little hitch. It would appear as though a frame was missing or an extra frame appeared and that kind of thing. And it's really because you just need to match the frame rate that you're rendering at to the frame rate of the final video. And you can see there's some options here to very quickly remap the speed of your video effectively. So you can say this is in percent. So this is the old percent was 100, the new percent was 100. If you set that to 50, your video is going to be twice as long, obviously. So you set your dimensions, you set your frame rate and your start and end frame. You define what file format to use, whether you're going to need black and white, RGB or RGB with alpha, 8 or 16 meg, the level of compression. I'm assuming we've already set everything else, but then there's one extra consideration under sampling. You're always going to have a level of noise. Even a SLR camera that takes a photograph will have a level of noise, basically noise being these variations. So you could think, if you were to look at this as a real object, you wouldn't see these discrete dots that are bright and dark. You actually do see that. It's just your brain corrects for it because even your eye has a level of noise. In real time, each of these pixels would be flashing. They would be changing their brightness slightly. So if you took a video of a still object, particularly if it's got a gradient of brightness or color across it, and then zoom in on that video and just look at the individual pixels, these will actually be changing brightness. Even if the camera is completely still and the light is completely static, they will still be changing brightness slightly. And that's basically noise in the CCD or the film in the camera. And one moment the system decides that pixel is that bright. The next moment there's a bit of extra noise in there, a bit of random brightness appears as it were, and it'll be slightly brighter or slightly darker and so on. So these two pixels might in real life be, there might be the same amount of light bouncing into the camera from them, but at any given moment, one relative to the other would appear to be slightly brighter or slightly dimmer. And effectively, fireflies are an extreme version of that. The problem is that because this is a 3D render, when something is moving, for example, when the camera might be panning through this scene, the calculation of the scene starts at the same point. There is a certain amount of randomness applied as to where it's going to end up and where it's going to stop looking for light bounces, for example. We're not doing infinite light bounces. And that's part of why we don't get a perfect scene. And because of that, depending on where, if you like, it starts, will depend on how bright that pixel's going to be in a given frame and how bright that pixel's going to be in a given frame. Because obviously the light's reflecting in slightly different direction. So it might get slightly more or slightly less bounces before Blender gives up and says, oh, that's the brightness of that one, and moves on to the next one. Changing the seed means if, for all intents and purposes, it's going to start in a different place. It doesn't quite work that way, but you can imagine it starting somewhere else before it starts the render. That would mean it would get to this pixel at a different point in the scene. So it might even look at this pixel first before it got to that one, in which case their relative brightnesses, they might be the same or they might be completely different. So from one scene to another, changing the seed value will change the noise pattern, if you like, on the scene. If you don't change the seed in an animation, then that same pattern will apply every time. So this pixel, if the scene isn't moving, will always be slightly brighter pixel. This one will be that slightly darker pixel. And you can effectively see this when the camera is panning. It almost looks like there's a sort of screen in front of the camera and there's little noise effectively on that screen. You can imagine basically a projection screen and there's tiny little dots or some spatters of paint or something on that projection screen. And as the scene moves around, those spatters of paint stay static. So it's a little bit of noise as if you're looking through that noise. And it's a little bit distracting to the eye. But if you can make it change every scene, so a different relative brightness occurs between pixels, between every frame, not scene, then it's much less noticeable to the eye because this is 25 frames a second. Now, I used to do it with a little driver that I type into there, but you no longer need to do that. All you need to do is click this little clock symbol, and that will effectively, every time we move to a new frame, it will apply a different seed. And that will mean, if it's set to 25 frames a second, every 25th of a second, a different seed will be applied. So you will, if you look carefully, you will see the noise as a sort of subtle shimmering across the whole scene, depending on how much noise there is. But it won't be specific. It won't be in the same place all the time. So it's much less noticeable. It doesn't reduce the amount of noise. It just means it's a different noise pattern for every frame. And that's the main one you need to be aware of for animation. Always, always click that button, unless by some miracle you have a scene with zero noise in it, which you might do if you were doing OpenGL or something like that. I could get into a lot of detail on render layers. I'm not going to do that, but I will talk a little bit about denoising. Render layers is basically an opportunity for you to do different things, apply different effects to different layers. It's very much used when you're compositing, perhaps, animation over live action and things like that, and for other effects as well. But denoising, if we turn on denoising here, we get some default values. So here's my scene. I'm going to re-render this scene again at my current settings of 25. So there it is. Got a bit of noise in the scene, and that's done at a sample rate of 25 samples. That's not very many samples. Now we'll go to slot 5, but this time I'm going to turn the denoising on with all the default levels and press F12. So that's rendered. It took 8.5 seconds compared to 5.4, so it does add some time. But here's the original scene. Try and remember the amount of noise, and here's the new one. So immediately it's a much more pleasing scene because it's less noisy. However, especially as a 3D artist, when you start to look in a little more detail, there are a few things which are a bit unsatisfactory. So if we start with this area, that looks fine, really. It actually looks quite nice. We know this is a subdivision surface object, so it looks very smooth and pleasing. This looks okay too, as does the ground. Something a little odd happening at this edge here, but otherwise this one's fine. The worst area is this caustics here and the sphere over here. Not sure whether it'll be picked up in YouTube, but there's almost a sort of patches of blurring occurring around here. Like JPEG compression. Now, in a still scene, you can often get away with that. So if this was satisfactory, then that's it. That's your scene done. It was only 25 samples. It only took 8.5 seconds to render, and there it is. So you could do a few more samples and it would look very good indeed. However, in an animation, it's almost like the noise, these little patches, these little blurry bits are going to move around and they can be quite distracting. Fortunately, we can change some of the options here. So let's go to slot 6. Subsurface seemed to be fine, so we'll leave that on. Transmission, in other words, that sphere, seemed to be quite bad. So let's turn off direct and indirect. So indirect, obviously, it's light that's bouncing first. Direct is light that isn't. Glossy, that was a glossy sphere. That seemed to be causing us some problems, as did the mirrored object. Let's turn that off. And the diffuse seemed to be fine. So we're going to leave on diffuse and subsurface, but we've turned off denoising for the other two. So let's see how that does. So it's clearly a little noisier. It's actually 8.6. I don't know why it's slightly slower, but nevertheless, let's compare this to slot 5. So slot 5 is clearly the least noisy. there's extra noise appeared on here, and we've got a noise back here because obviously we've turned off denoising. This might be where you want to use branched path tracing, because you might want to specifically select transmission as something where you want to calculate more samples, whereas you perhaps don't need to for diffuse, because so the diffuse areas in here look fine. You notice we haven't got that artifact along this edge now, but we do have noise. If I put this back to affecting everything, then I'm going to click relative filter. So this will try to identify features in the scene and make a best guess on how it applies the denoising based on those features. So let's see what that looks like. One of the elements I think they could improve would be to allow us to control the denoising such that we don't have to carry out a new render to then do denoising. It would be nice to be able to do denoising afterward. So let's compare this, which took 8.4 seconds, to the previous denoised scene. So there's something changing here. That's actually slightly better. It's a slightly smoother effect there. So let's have a look at this area. Something's changed, but it still looks pretty rough. It's not that much improved. But what we can do is we can turn down the feature strength. So this is just now making it effectively be more gentle in the denoising. So let's compare that to the previous one. So there's the fully denoised one with default settings. And here's the one with the reduced denoising, but not zero. So you can see some of the noise has come back and it's almost more distracting. It's back in certain areas, but it's not as severe. We haven't got the artifact along there. So you could adjust this to give you the effect you want. But let's turn that up slightly. And then radius. So this is effectively how many pixels it looks around to determine what it should do to the pixel of interest at that moment. So let's set the radius down to 2. So that's a very tight denoising now. We've put the feature strength and strength back up, but we've made it look at a much more narrow range of pixels now. So you can see we've got a different effect again. It's actually more noise across the scene, but the noise itself is larger. It's effectively blurred the individual noise blips. So if we compare that to 5, it only took 6.6 seconds, by the way, because it's not looking at as many pixels. If we look at 5, we see that was at 8, a radius of 8, and that's much more smooth. We go to 6, it is noisier. And again, this noise will be more of a problem when you're doing an animation. So be very careful about using denoising for an animation. It's very tempting to use it because it allows you to have less samples, but it can also cause you more problems than it solves. So let's go the other way. Bear in mind, you may have problems if you go too big with the memory of the card, if you're using GPU rendering. And I should have said, particularly with denoising, larger tile sizes can easily overrun the memory in your card. So be aware of that. Now this took a lot longer to render. This took more than 22 seconds to render. But it's created a reasonably smooth effect. So I had this with a radius of 20. So it was looking at a relatively large area to determine what to do with the pixels it had. But let's compare this back to slot 5. Slot 5, this is the default settings, was obviously a pretty good starting point. We've still got a bit of an artifact down here. It's perhaps not as bad. This part of the scene actually looks fine. I can't see any noise. I've got sufficient detail. I wouldn't say there's any problem with that at all. This area is perhaps better than it was. So there's slot 5, here's slot 6, but it's still not perfect. There's still some artifacts here and so on. And that's a radius of 20, which is relatively large. And we've still got some artifacts on this edge here. So denoising is great. It has its applications, but it isn't an answer to all your problems. It's one of those things you're going to need to determine, is it suitable for the scene that I'm trying to do? It has more applications, I think, in single frame renders than it does in animation. It becomes much more noticeable in animation at the moment. And I think the developers have even said it's not really ready for animation yet. And you certainly need to try to understand what it's doing and how you're going to use it. So understanding how this bit works is going to help a lot. So we've come to the end now. I hope you found that useful, and I hope you're now ready to go and render your own animation or still frame. Thanks a lot, and I'll see you in the next tutorial. Bye for now. So I hope you found that interesting. If you did, let me know. If you enjoy these tutorials, don't forget to click like and subscribe. I also have a Facebook page and a Twitter account, and I now have a Patreon page as well. And I'll provide links to all of those in the description below. So I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.